A very, very warm good afternoon to everyone. Let me take this opportunity to invite and welcome our own Dean, Dr. Sanjeev Galande, who is currently the Dean of School of Natural Sciences and HOD of Life Sciences Department at Shivnathu University. Dr. Galande brings with him over two decades of experience as renowned cell biologist and epigenetist. He has worked with ICER Pune as Professor of Biology and as Dean of Research and Development. He has earned his PhD from ISC and worked as postgraduate postdoctoral fellow at Lawrence Berkeley National Lab in US. He has received numerous fellowship awards and recognition, including Shanti Swarup Bhatnagar Prize, G.D. Birla Award, J.C. Bose Fellowship, and many more. Dr. Galande, the floor is yours, and we are all eagerly waiting for your talk.
Thank you, Rajiv, for this very kind introduction, and also for asking me to be the opening batsman for this particular series of talks. So let's see how it goes. I thought, therefore, I've selected a theme that is closer to my research interests, but also I'll highlight some of the most recent advances in terms of research. Not necessarily that of biological research, life sciences research, but also encompassing multiple different disciplines, and actually to emphasize on all the students that the amalgamation of multiple disciplines and use of multiple resources, tools, is ultimately what develops new technologies and enables us to actually solve some of the most interesting and fundamental problems in sciences. So the topic that I've chosen today is about how nature and nurture together make what we are. And believe me, the kind of examples I have chosen to give today are actually the kind of examples that will appeal to all of you, because they are part of our day-to-day life. These examples will tell you something completely new perspective on health and diseases. So, though it's about epigenetics and it's about genomics, I will also touch upon various other ways in which this technology has developed, which has enabled us to now go towards what is called as personalized medicine. Medicine for each and every individual, okay? Because we are all very different from each other, not necessarily genetically, but in so many other ways. And I'll talk about what those other ways are. And then understanding those differences that make each one of us so different in terms of our behavior, in terms of our habits, in terms of what we do in our lives, our lifestyles, how can that knowledge be used to get some kind of a rationalized input towards therapies to multiple lifestyle disorders? So that's going to be the conclusion of this talk. So this is how I've divided the talk. So initially, when I begin, I'm going to give you a brief introduction to epigenetics. I believe this talk is being attended by many students who are not necessarily biologists. And therefore, it's more a generalized introduction. So pardon some of the life sciences students who might have seen equivalent slides and videos, but I'll try to make it as entertaining as possible. So if I can share my presentation. How do I do that? Yes. Can you see my slides? Okay, good.
Yes, sir.
Title of today's talk is, as I said, Nature and Nurture Together, How They Shape the Genes. And these are the genes that we talk about, which are part of our genome. And I'll give you a glimpse of what these words mean. So the first picture I'm going to show you is something that I had seen 15 years ago at a public exhibit of the Wellcome Trust in London. Wellcome Trust is one of the largest non-governmental funding bodies in the world. It's based in UK, out of a pharmaceutical company. And this particular non-profit enterprise has spearheaded one of the most interesting research problems, which research projects rather, which was the Human Genome Project. They funded quite a large part of it. So after the Human Genome Project and its results were announced in 2001, they opened this as part of their public outreach in a museum which is open to the public, just for people to appreciate the science behind this. And this is a very fascinating concept that you can actually allow common people who have necessarily no access to any lab or have never studied science formally can actually appreciate science. And this is a very wonderful example of that. So what you see in this picture is actually a stack of books. It's like when you go to the library, you can see all kinds of shelves with different books. The volumes here, actually the numbers, if you can read them, tell you something. So if you see from top to bottom, there is number 1, 2, 3, 4, all the way up to 22, and then X and Y. So for those of you who have studied a little bit of biology, will definitely tell me that these are the number of chromosomes in our cells. Obviously, each nucleus in a body contains 23 pairs of chromosomes, which contain all the genes. What you see here in this stack of books, the entire shelf contains one single copy of our genome. Okay, literally a single print. If you have a genome stored in your computer and you hit the print command, this is what the output will be. Okay, it is volume stacks of volumes, and it's humongous information. It's mind-boggling that each cell of our body carries so much information. Okay, the first time I saw this, despite knowing the facts, I was actually completely stunned. And I'm going to try to recreate this kind of thing over here, just to, for everyone to appreciate the volume of information that we have. So if you go closer at eye level, the book that is open in the middle of the shelf, actually try to read what is there inside. This is what you see. And this is the information that is printed across all of this. So when you see this, you'll see that there are only four alphabets, A, C, T, and G, not the 26 alphabet like what you are familiar with in case of English literature. And then obviously what is again noticed here is that there are no punctuation marks. You don't see full stop, you don't see any other punctuation mark, okay? In fact, not even a question mark, though there are lots of questions when I see this, because how do we know what this information encodes? And how does, most importantly, how does the cellular machinery know that where do the genes begin and where do they end? Because this is an endless, it's like a continuous string of characters, you know? There is no end to it. It's not a single sentence. So the bottom line here is that when you open this volume of books, any book from this library, what is the grammar? Normally, typically, if you go to any library and open any book, and it could be any language, it could be Tamil, it could be Punjabi, or it could be a Bengali. Just pick up any book and start randomly going through it. You'll be able to appreciate or understand that there are chapters. Then a sentence begins somewhere, ends somewhere. You can identify question marks, exclamation marks. So you can understand grammar without knowing much of the language. Okay, that is because of the structure of the grammar. In this case, for the genetic information, we don't understand the grammar of it. So in the 80s and the 90s, large numbers of scientists actually really struggled hard to understand the grammar of this language. And that's when the genetic code came about, which led to several Nobel Prizes. So this is a sequence, one such sequence for a single gene, okay? And mind you, I have chosen one of the smallest genes. Otherwise, gene sequences can be really, really long, okay? There are only a few thousand alphabets here. So now, when I present this sequence to you, obviously, it will be very difficult for many of you to understand what does this represent. Even to me right now, it's difficult for me to tell exactly where a gene begins and where does it end, and what is all the sequence about. Now, of course, I can tell you this because of all the research that has happened, that this sequence of a gene called HOX1A encodes for a particular gene which is having these kind of characteristics. So now the color coding will actually decode the grammar of this based on all the understanding. We know that the first alphabet in red, the ATG triplet, is the start codon. And then you also see the stop codon, TGA, on the other side. And in between, in the blue color, is what you have as the coding sequence, the sequence that codes for the protein called as HOX1A that will be made out of this particular gene. But then, what is the sequence in green? What is the sequence in brown? Many other colors. So these sequences also have some role to play. Okay, it's not necessarily only the blue sequence that gives rise to the protein is important. Many other sequences inside and outside of so-called gene structure are also very important. So what are their roles? In fact, that is where the science of epigenetics becomes extremely important. So I'm going to tell you about how that works. So this is the sequence of HOX1A, and we think that this gives the complete picture. But really, is that true? This is genetics, okay? We are decoding the genetic code, the start codon, stop codon, introns, exons, the split genes, upstream sequences, downstream sequences, all of that. But is that really enough? Is this information completely sufficient to understand the function and the role of this particular gene? Maybe not. And why not? So that's what I'm going to talk about. So let's look at the genomic context. Okay, so assembly of genes is basically the genome. The numbers that you saw on the picture, 22 chromosomes and the X and Y sex chromosomes together make our genome. Okay, and that genome is pretty large, 3.3 billion alphabets. Okay, 3.3 units make that entire genome. It's a huge number, astronomical number. But is that what defines complexity? Okay, many of you have heard of evolution, and we believe that we are at the apex of evolution, that we have evolved so much that there is no species on earth which is more evolved than us. So obviously people believed, and that's what was the more or less school of thought, that before the Human Genome Project, that, and in fact the motivation for doing this project was that people thought they will discover lots of new genes, maybe hundreds of thousands of genes which were unknown at that point of time. Only a few thousand genes were known, but they believed that there will be so many more genes that make us so uniquely human. So many like genes that give rise to intelligence, our behavior, complex functions like speech, cognition, etc. So that's why there was a big race to solve the human genome sequence. What did it do? So let's look at the genomic context, and this graph actually is a log scale. Okay, on the x-axis, if you see, it's a log scale. That means any small increment actually gives rise to a huge change in the genome size. And now if you look from top to bottom, the way it is organized is the earlier species, okay, the protozoans, even that before that, the archaea, then the bacteria, and then fungi, and then algae, and then plants, insects, etc., etc. So as you go down this particular graph from top to bottom, you'll see that species have evolved from unicellular bacteria to unicellular eukaryotes like yeasts, and then of course plants, animals of various types. And we know that amphibians like frog are much earlier to mammals or reptiles, and therefore we believe that this is how the progression of complexity happened. To some extent, this is true. Human beings are probably some of the most complex organisms on this planet. But look at the genome sizes. When you look at the genome sizes, what you actually find is that the genome of humans, so if you look at mammals at the bottom here, and humans are marked very nicely here, is not having the highest size of the genome. I'll tell you, if I give you examples of species that have much larger genomes than humans, you'll be surprised. Even onion, okay, something that we eat almost every day, has much larger genome. Onion plant, okay, has much larger genome than humans. Some frogs have much larger, 10 times larger genomes than human beings, even lizards. Forget that. The unicellular amoeba has 100 times larger genome than the human genome, okay? And this was one of the most revealing facts. Actually, it just crushed our ego that we thought that human beings are the most complex species on earth. We'll have the biggest genome, and therefore we'll be able to mine it, right? Large number of pharmaceutical companies came up just with the hope that they will be able to mine this huge amount of data and come up with new genes, new targets, new drug targets, and make a lot of money. Obviously, after the sequence and its analysis was published, most of them went bankrupt. And we realized that no, it's not the size of the genome. It's not the number of genes that actually make us as complex as we think we are. Then what is it? Okay, so this is the first thing I would like you to remember, that does it really matter how many genes we have? And the answer to this question is almost meaningless because there are multiple different ways by which these genes can actually manifest themselves. So one of them that each gene can give rise to several proteins, not just one protein. Okay, so there are permutations, combinations because of the split genes. So you can actually have permutations, combinations of these split genes. From one genetic unit, you can make 10 or 12 different proteins. One very good example right now, everybody is aware of this, that's why I'm telling you, is some of the viruses like HIV, SARS-CoV-2, okay, the one that causes COVID. These viruses have very small genomes, but you know, they're smartly divided. You know, each part of this genome gives rise to multiple proteins through use of alternate fragments, okay? So this mix and match maximizes the coding potential of the genome, okay? So nature has learned this way early, even in viruses. And in fact, viruses are, that's why, very smart genomes, because every alphabet is most efficiently utilized because they have to have a small genome to package in their small body. Whereas we can afford to have large amount of genetic information which may not necessarily give rise to proteins. And I'll come to that. It was believed to be a redundant part of our genome. But now we know through the studies on genetics and epigenetics that that's not redundant. So this is how each protein can be modified then in multiple ways. And then of course, protein A can form complex with protein B, that can form complex with protein C. You can have complex of A, B, and C. So proteins can actually form groups. They can come together. So the properties of A alone versus A and B together will be very different. Okay. And this is how, again, through permutations and combinations, you can have multiple proteins with multiple different functions arising out of a limited set of genes. And the reason I say this again is, let me throw some numbers at you, which will again make you appreciate what I mean. The number of genes that are encoded by human genome are between 22 to 23,000. Okay. And if you look at any fly outside in the garden, or even the fruit fly, okay, we think that they will have very few genes. No, they also have 15 to 20,000 genes. Not many different than us. You take close relatives like other mammals, say mouse. Mouse has almost exactly the same number of genes as are encoded in our body. But then, of course, mouse looks very different, behaves very different than us. So it is not the number of genes that make us what we are. And that's the bottom line of starting to think about what is beyond the genes, what is something that extracts much more meaning out of this genome that the genes alone can actually tell us. And that is exactly the genesis of epigenetics. So that brings me to this topic of what understanding what the genomic material actually is organized as. And it's organized as a complex called chromatin, which is allowing this entire bulk of genomic DNA to be packaged into the tiny volume of the nucleus. If you take all these 23 pairs of chromosomes and arrange them end to end, so let's say I'll take these two pens, okay? This is one chromosome, this is another chromosome. And if you take all the 22 pairs and arrange them end to end, the total length will be more than 6 feet, okay? Much larger than the tip of this right arm to the left arm. That much of long thread of DNA, if you want to package in a small spherical nucleus, which is smaller than the tip of a pin or a needle, how would you do that? Okay, and you can't just crumple the whole thing together and throw it in this nucleus, because you have to understand at one particular time you need gene number 143 and some other time you need gene number 18,500. You have to actually extract that information. So you can't just package it just like this. It has to be a systematic packaging. And the way nature does it is again very, very beautiful. What do we do? Let's say you want to package a long thread. Of course, you package it by coiling. Okay. So nature has evolved this mechanism where exactly the same thing is done. And because DNA, deoxyribonucleic acid, because it's acidic, it forms a complex with something that is basic. Okay. You remember opposite poles attract. So DNA gets complex with proteins which are basic. So acidic DNA and the basic proteins form a very nice tight bond. And that's the best way of putting them together. So these basic proteins are called histones, and they are like this, like balls around which the DNA is wrapped around. So these form coiled coils, okay? And these coiled coils look like this. So the central ball that you see is the core of the proteins, which is the histone basic proteins around which the thread of DNA is coiled. So what I'm going to do is I'm actually going to show you an animation which will summarize this entire process. So this is the DNA, the double helical structure, very beautiful structure, solved by Watson and Crick. And of course, they use data from many other people, including Rosalind Franklin and Linus Pauling, to come to this structure. And then you can see these proteins in the purple color are being now formed into a kind of a structure, which is a coiled coil called nucleosome. And this array of nucleosomes is what make the compaction possible. Okay, so you'll see how this coiling proceeds. So this is how DNA gets compacted by packing and making much larger threads, which are sort of coiled together to make coil-coil kind of structure. And they organize into multiple sized fragments, as you will see here. And these coils are extremely well organized and they can compact and decompact. So it's like a spring which gets compact or it gets opened up depending upon the requirement. Okay, so you can allow genes to be either accessed by pulling them apart, or if you don't want them, they can be compacted and kept somewhere else. So this is similar, very similar to how we pack our things. Now this is actually not zooming out, and this is real, okay? A real dividing cell, no more an animation. And we'll see that the chromosomes are dancing and then finding their counterparts, and they come together at the center, okay, at the metaphase plate. And now the cell is going to divide. So the genetic material also has to divide. And you can see that it's nicely dividing. The chromosomes separate and go to the opposite poles, and the two daughter cells pinch off. Okay, so now you have two cells out of one cell. This is how the genetic material divides. And we saw at the end that the compacted chromosomes started unwinding. Okay, so this constant breathing goes on to follow the entire process of accessibility. So this is possible again through modifications of the histones, and the histone proteins have these tails which are decorated very nicely. So all the flags that are shown here, I will not go into details of what those are, but those are the decorations that again dictate different meaning or impart different meaning to this particular organization, whether it can be compact or loose. And all this thing constantly, this breathing process constantly happens inside every cell of our body depending upon what it receives as signals. So precisely what does this do? All these modifications are actually what we call as the epigenetic modifications, because they do not change the underlying sequence. They only modify it a little bit. So that is similar to what example I'm showing you right now. This is a textbook paragraph, talks a little bit about epigenetics. And now if you're studying this as a student, let's say you're studying this for an exam, what you do then is, okay, I cannot remember all the words in this particular paragraph. I would just highlight the most important one so that I can revise only that short part just the day before the exam, so that I get the entire memory back. So that's what you do. Okay, you highlight the important parts in different colors. Okay, something in yellow, in orange, or you underline also, like at the bottom, the word epigenetic is underlined. This is precisely the difference between genetics and epigenetics. Okay. If you change a single word here, that may change the meaning, right? You are actually changing the meaning by altering the words here. That's what happens if you change the sequence of genes, which gives rise to genetic diseases. But if you change only the highlights, you're not changing the meaning of this text, okay? You're only extracting what you think is the important information here. If somebody else reads the entire thing, might highlight some other parts, not exactly necessarily the same things, right? So that is the individual difference between two people despite having the same genes. So the HOX1A gene that I talked about will be, the sequence of this gene will be 100% identical between my cells and all of your cells. Okay, so that is genetics. At gene level, the identity is almost 100% between two individuals, even non-related individuals, and not just between humans, even with humans and related species like other mammals, okay, like apes or even mouse. And that's why we can study animals and then derive something out of human physiology, because the genes are almost identical. And people have done experiments where they have actually swapped genes across species. You can actually swap, take human gene, put it in mouse, and study its function. Okay, so recently for studying COVID, that's exactly what we did. We remove the receptor for the virus, ACE2. Okay, mouse sequence does not bind the SARS-CoV-2 spike protein. Okay, so we remove that and put human ACE2 gene in the mouse so that mouse can respond to the virus. Okay, so obviously then you can use the mouse model for studying COVID-like diseases. Otherwise, you can't use that. So all of this is part of the work that can be done to understand, because obviously you can't do all these experiments in humans. That's how you can exploit genetic tools to understand biology. But coming to epigenetics, here you're not changing the alphabets, you're not changing the gene sequence, you're only extracting different meaning out of it because of the highlights. And that's exactly what happens in our body all the time, because your genes won't change, you're born with it. So that is what is the science of epigenetics, which it's a branch of biology which studies causal interactions between genes and their products, okay, which are proteins and other phenotypes, and without changing the gene sequence. So Waddington, who actually proposed this, he was a British geneticist. In the 50s, he proposed this hypothesis. So what it means in real terms is depicted in this video here. Okay, so I'm going to play this animation again. What it shows is how genes are differentially modified as we develop. All of you are aware that we begin our life as a single cell, okay? So the ovum is fertilized by the sperm. You have a single fertilized embryo. Initially, it's a single cell, and then that divides into two cells. Those divide into four cells, and then keeps on dividing multiply. Until a certain time, these cells are identical, okay? You can just replace each one and it's still fine. And that's how you get identical twins. Okay, because those two are alike after the first division. After that, if they get separated, they can develop into two individuals, which are identical in their genetic counterparts. But then something starts happening after a few divisions and cells slowly start becoming unlike each other. Okay, and they keep on moving and moving and moving, dividing and dividing and dividing, and structures form. So that the embryo then will soon have something in the front, something at the back, something on the top, something at the bottom, the left side and the right side. Slowly, all of this kind of gets, the division happens, okay? So that is called the lineage mapping or cell fate determination. During that process, different genes actually, so this is the black cells are individual cells that divide, they're alike. But as they start moving along the embryo and as they acquire different signals, they change their properties and you start now the changing colors, okay? These changing colors actually indicate that these cells are now slowly acquiring different signals. Their genes are getting highlighted in different colors so that despite having identical genome sequence, they turn into different types of cells. So the cell on the right-hand side is a neuron. It's an extended cell, okay? Like the cells in the brain, whereas the cell on the extreme left is an RBC, okay, in the blood. So look at their size and shape, so much difference. And there are cells at the center which have cilia, okay, these are columnar epithelial cells which are lining your respiratory tract. So initially, all of them are actually identical. How did we arrive at such diverse shapes and functions? That is the beauty of epigenetics. So these cells have 100% identity at the genetic level, but because their epigenetic changes, the highlights have been so different, they have acquired different phenotypes. What you see there are phenotypes, okay? That's the external form of these cells. And this is one of the examples of epigenetics, how it changes the phenotype despite having the same genotype. And because of which now epigenetics is being used for understanding multiple diseases like cancer, aging, diabetes, etc. And that's what the examples I'm going to give you about. And because of this, epigenetics, of course, is the center stage of disease research, and it's considered one of the most important revolution in modern biology. And if you look at all these magazines, the titles are quite revealing. Time magazine says, "Why your DNA isn't your destiny." Okay, which is what I said. It's not what matters, what genes you have, something else. So what is that? What is your destiny? The study in National Geographic is about identical twins. So genetically identical twins, if they are brought up in different environment, can actually start looking different, as well as they can also behave differently. So that is what is the beauty of epigenetics. So I'm now going to give you examples of how one studies epigenetics and how that can be used to understand very important questions in life sciences. So one beautiful example of how phenotype can be changed with epigenetics is this in bees. In fact, in large number of social insects, people have done these experiments, because social insects have a built-in structure hierarchy in the society, which we call as the caste system. It's not a correct way of saying it, but let's say this is the caste system based on the work that they do. So there is a beehive, let's say, and it has number of workers, thousands of worker bees, which we know, that's what we see outside. Their only job is every day they go out, fetch nectar and come back and make honey and store it. Okay, so they are really hardworking bees, but thousands of worker bees are doing one job, but then there is only single bee, which is called queen bee. And the queen bee actually is much different than these. Worker bees have a particular size. Queen bee is 40-50% larger in size. The only thing that queen bee does is eat a lot the food that is brought by workers and lays eggs, hundreds of eggs every day. Okay, that's the only work she does. Now, interestingly, the presence of the queen bee is very important for the survival of the hive. Okay, in fact, if you take the queen bee away, the workers will either desert the entire beehive, or sometimes very nice changes start happening. One of the worker bees transforms itself into a queen bee. Okay, now this is amazing. At one point of time, the worker bee worked like a worker bee, but then something happens. There's an epigenetic switch, and the worker bee becomes a queen bee and starts laying eggs, does not make honey, just keeps eating. How does it happen? So this change of phenotype is what is basically an epigenetic change. And people have seen that between nurse bees, forager bees, everything that happens because of epigenetic changes, the highlights that happen, the chemical changes that happen to their gene modifications, methylation, acetylation, etc., which are very small chemical groups that are added to these proteins, the histone proteins, as well as to DNA, can change their function dramatically. That is through the packaging and depackaging opening of phenomenon. Okay, so just based on that, you can have such a huge difference between structure or phenotype and function of a living being. So this was one of the first striking examples of how this can happen. So now I'll give an idea about how environment can influence susceptibility to non-communicable disorders. So coming more towards health. Okay, so the first question is, can diet cause heritable changes in physiology via epigenetic changes in gene expression? Okay, so here the experiment was, and this was done more than 10 years ago, one of the most epic papers, I would say, is to provide chronically high fat diet. So let's say for 2 to 3 months to one set of animals, and this was done in rats. So 3 months in life of a rat is equivalent to 15, 20 years in human lifetime, okay? Because they live for about 2 years in experimental colonies. In wild, it could be even shorter. So you are exposing them chronically for a long period of time. 10 to 15 years is a very long period of time, right? To high fat diet. And then they allowed those fathers to reproduce. Females have not had chronically high fat diet, only fathers have had. And then looked at the effect in the female offspring of the next generation. And what was found was quite profound, that fathers that were fed with high fat diet actually gave rise to the next generation, the progeny, especially the females, who had dysfunction of their beta cells, which are the cells in your islets, which is the pancreas. Okay. And these cells, beta cells, secrete insulin. Okay. So it has something to do with our ability to consume sugar, okay, glucose utilization. So that is actually a precursor step to developing diabetes. So which actually indicates that chronic high fat diet treatment led to predisposing your next generation to susceptibility for type 2 diabetes. Okay, so the next generation, the females, actually have not eaten high fat diet. They have actually just eaten regular food. So it is just because of something that was done by your parents or forefathers that is affecting you now, okay? And more such examples I'll give you, which will basically tell you that what we actually believe is our fate is not necessarily just because of what we have done. It could be actually multi-generational. And there are multiple experiments that we have done with collaborators that actually are very strong indicators that this could actually run across multiple generations, okay? So the conclusion, this actually is not my conclusion. This was the News and Views article in this particular journal that said this, that fat fathers can actually affect their daughter's health, okay? I'll come back to this example. The next example is not about diet. It's about the state of mind, okay? What happens if you have different activities to your brain, stimulated brain versus very, very sedentary and rusted brain? So does brain activity and the state of mind influence gene expression and eventually our health? How do we do this experiment, right? It's a complex experiment to do. So the way the experiment was done is to take again two sets of animals, okay? And one set of animals, you expose them to what is called as a enriched environment. Typically, if you go to any animal facility, animals are in a cage, small cage, because obviously if you let them loose, they will run away. So, and also for management, it becomes easier. So it's a 1 square foot, let's say, area, and there are 4 or 5 animals, mice or rats in that area, and nicely covered, okay? So let's say 1 cubic foot is the area in which they have to live for their life. So they're thoroughly bored because they have nothing to do. They can't explore like they do in the wild, and they have to eat only the same food every day because it's boring, right? If you eat same food every day. So that's how their life is, very bored. They have nothing to do. Sometimes they become very aggressive because of that. So that is your control animal set. And in the experimental animal set, what was done was they were provided enrichment. And the way you do that is by providing this kind of a bigger cage. You can see now it's 1 meter long and much bigger cage. And it has all kinds of toys. As you see inside this, there is also a treadmill where the rat is actually running. So you provide them various activities, you provide them exercise, you provide them different textured surfaces, and they can do all these things which normally they could do in the wild, okay? This is a mimic of that. Obviously, it can't be the same, but it's a mimic of that. Slightly better environment. So they are enriched every day. There is something new. You change the position of these next day, put some new toy. So every day they have a stimulating or enriched environment. So one group is in a boring environment. Another group is in an enriched environment. And again, you do this for 3 months, okay? Equivalent to 15 years of our lives. And then do the experiment. So once you get them used to this, what you do is then there is an experimental protocol called xenograft, in which cancer-promoting cells from humans can be implanted into animals like mouse or rats. So that's across the species, right? From humans to rats. That's why it is the xenograft experiment. If you do it on the same species, then it's not xenograft, it's allograft. So basically you just put it across different species, and these are immunocompromised animals, so therefore they can accept the graft, and then you can actually see that the graft localizes into the organ where the tumor actually forms, okay? So it's a tumorigenesis experiment. So you basically impose cancer on these animals. The results are actually mind-boggling. The animals which had gone through the enriched environment experience did not develop any tumor, whereas those who were in the boring cages, boring environment, actually developed huge lumps of tumors. And that is what is shown here. Okay, I will not show you the pictures of the animals, just summarizing this data. So what actually happens is all these sensory inputs that we get through our eyes, ears, touch, smell, everything, all of that goes inside the brain, and in the brain, there are certain regions. So hypothalamus is the seat for behavior. There is a gene called BDNF, okay? I'll come back to this gene in the next example. The arrow going up means the gene is upregulated. It is increased in activity, and somehow that signal gets passed on to the rest of the body, and the tumor actually gets inhibited because another gene called leptin is downregulated. So this connection actually between different parts of the body is very important for developing any disease. In this case, when you give sensory inputs, the environmental enrichment, it changes the gene expression in different parts of the body. And that's what causes downregulation of tumor. So simply put, I mean, this is a very simplistic statement. It's not necessarily true exactly in the same way that if you are happy, if you are satisfied with life, there's a chance that rather lower chance that you'll develop any disease like tumors. Okay, that's actually what this means. I will give you another example. Now this is coming to mental health, which is becoming again a very big challenge these days, especially. And that has something to do with early life experiences. Okay, all of us go through different experiences all throughout our life. But what actually matters the most in case of in terms of our behavioral patterns, in terms of our makeup, mental makeup, as well as in terms of our emotional and mental health, is something that happens very early in life. Okay, and that's why people say that early life experiences are very important. So there are animal models that are developed for corresponding human cases. Okay, so I'll tell you about this. So the postnatal environment just after birth, okay, animals can be, humans are subject to abuse, neglect, parental neglect, like what happens to street kids, some kind of trauma. Obviously, you can't put human beings through this. Ethically, it is not permitted. Even animals, you can't put through all of this. Ethically, it is not permitted. But what is permitted ethically are experiments that I will talk about. So one kind of trauma or stress that you can induce in animal model is called maternal separation. Okay, the one in red in this particular slide. I'll describe the experiment. What basically is done is as soon as the children, the pups are born, there is a litter of typically on an average 10 to 11 pups. They are very dependent on their mother. In fact, for the first 14 days, their eyes are not even opened. The eyelids are closed. And therefore, they are totally dependent on the mother. They cannot see anything. They are only looking for touch, availability of food, which is milk, mother's milk, etc. They can't chew into hard rat chows. So they need the mother, which is like a 100% obligatory requirement. So now every day is 24 hours of time together with mother. If you remove them for 3 hours, put it in another cage where they cannot smell the mother, they cannot see or hear the mother, and then bring them back after 3 hours, then they have sufficient time to again get acclimatized, eat and be happy. So that separation actually creates anxiety, okay, in these animals, which can be measured. And that has been done. I'm talking about experiments which are done and published now. What we actually looked at is in this particular model where you are separating the animals and making them more anxious. Okay, so these are called anxiogenic signals, anything that can increases the anxiety. And then you look at what are the other changes. So that's the behavioral change. Increase in anxiety is a behavioral change. And then you look at what happens inside their brain. So then you go inside, look at the cells, the neurons, have they changed? Okay, and then you also look at what happens in a molecular level. You can actually go inside the nucleus, look at particular genes and look at their epigenetic modifications, the highlights that I talked about, and see if those have changed. And mind you, when we did this exercise, we actually found that when these animals go through the maternal separation, this kind of a trauma, there are measurable changes. Okay, the p value is 0.001, really profound changes in the brain, and a particular gene of a particular location in the brain, BDNF in hypothalamus, similar to the earlier experiment, if you remember, that gets modified epigenetically. And most importantly, now if you give pharmacological inhibitors, okay, you must have heard of antidepressants, again, a very common treatment these days, Prozac, for example, okay, Prozac is a very common name for antidepressants given to humans. Same drug was given to these animals, okay, and the chemical name of this drug is amitriptyline. So you give amitriptyline treatment to these maternally separated pups and see what happens. And again, surprisingly, their anxiety level goes back to normal. Okay, so pharmacologically, if you treat this, they have become less anxiogenic. Go back to the brain, look at the cells, they have become normal. And go back to the inside of the cells, look at the genes and their modifications. They have also gone back to the normal control levels. So this is how precise and how potent this entire program is. You can actually go back and look at the molecular level changes, and that becomes a seat of the emotional or the behavioral output. And now the sciences have come to the stage where we can actually address these mechanisms pinpointedly, okay? And that's the beauty of technology, and I'm going to now give you those examples. So this is pharmacological inhibition. Going even beyond, okay, the next experiment was to actually do behavioral intervention. So as I said, the mouse, okay, I'll take this. I have a computer mouse here. So if you take this mouse, and because they have not opened their eyes, they don't know what you are doing to them. You take a small brush, zero number brush with very soft hair. And after separating from the mother, you actually start stroking them with this brush. Okay. So the typical licking and grooming that the mother does to the pups, the human being who's doing this experiment actually is doing this. Okay. You keep doing that. And that also is sufficient to reverse the effects of the separation from the mother. Cellular level as well as molecular level, you see the same effects. So it's a very, very deep connect between your environment, your sensory inputs, and your genes. Okay. And that is becoming more and more apparent as we do more and more studies. And the connection is very beautiful because you can actually measure it. And it's the, I would say, the most direct correlation and causation that you can have. So let's talk about how one can do this. So that's where the science of different disciplines comes together. So that is the genomics revolution. This is one of the sequencers that we had used several years ago. Now this technology is outdated because every 3 years this technology becomes redundant. But then anyway, I have actually got the sequencer here now. We will have as an exhibit sometime soon. This machine, okay, which is 6 feet tall and 6 feet wide. It's a mammoth, in my opinion. Of course, nothing compared to the sequencers of the 90s. This is sequences from 2010 to 2015. It was active. And the cost is humongous. This machine costs close to 5.5 crores. Okay, so obviously not everybody, every lab, every institution can afford it. But this technology has changed. Now the new technology, if I show the sequencer, it is so huge that it can actually fit into the palm of my hand, okay? It looks like a stapler actually, and this is the newest technology, the most latest generation of sequencers. So obviously this can, this costs actually just 1 lakh rupees, okay? So I'm not kidding. And you just connect it with USB 3 cable to your laptop and you can start sequencing. And it's, the technology has changed so much that I'll show you from the company's website, this technology is so clean and cool. So you open this machine, there is ore inside. You can actually add the sample, okay, just one tiny drop, which contains all the DNA molecules to be sequenced. There's a protein attached to that, which is the motor protein in purple, that goes and attaches to the ore, okay? And now it will show you the pores. So these are large number of micropores, which are close to 2000 on the cell. The DNA molecules actually go and sit on the pore and start spooling like a thread going through the pore. So this is how that shows you how the tether will put the motor protein onto the pore. So the okay, so different. And wait, as a signal for a different so this technology has revolutionized the biological sciences, and because of which the cost of sequencing genomes has dropped dramatically. So the next generation devices have actually beaten Moore's law. Okay, for those of you who understand Moore's law, the inverse relationship between the density of semiconductors that you can accommodate on a unit area and the cost of it is defined by the Moore's law. And you can see that the cost of sequencing initially followed Moore's law, but after 2007, when the next generation sequencing technologies were invented, that drop is dramatic, okay? It has now beaten Moore's law, and this slide is actually old. Now the cost of sequencing human genome, which cost NIH and other Wellcome Trust, et cetera, total of over $3 billion, Now we can actually sequence the entire human genome in less than $500, okay, just in the span of 2 decades. So you can imagine 5 years from now, because of the sequencer that I showed you, first of all, it's small. It can be taken anywhere. People actually take this in their backpack with a laptop and go to fields to do sequencing of new bacterial species in a pond or somewhere else. If there is an outbreak of a virus which you want to identify quickly, you can take the sequencer with you. You don't need even lab to go with you. Okay, just a pipette, few tubes, the sequencer and a laptop. You go to the field, you can do this. So similarly, this can come into a pathological lab. You can actually have your genome sequences deduced, and everybody carries then a small pen drive to the doctor. When you want to consult a doctor, you take that pen drive, doctor will put in the computer, check your genetic kundali, and then decide, okay, this particular medicine is good for you. This is personalized medicine. And that is actually what is going to happen in the next 5 years. Okay, it's already happening for diseases like cancer. They check your frequency of allele, etc., for certain genetic mutants in few loci for few genes. But very quickly now we'll be able to understand across all the genes what is happening and prescribe medicines more effectively, so that you don't have much of side effects. Plus, you get much more relief in shortest period of time. So I'm just going to give you some technological inputs here, just to show how people from computational sciences, mathematics, statistics have contributed extensively to this explosion of technical breakthroughs in science, and that have assisted research in biology. So the sequence that comes out of this sequencers, if you see, the files look like this, okay? And what you see here, only 3 reads and their attributes, okay? It actually looks even more complex than the ASCII code, if you remember what ASCII code was. And imagine, one run will give you millions of such data points, okay? Millions and millions. The most recent sequencer that is out in the market, the highest throughput, actually throws out 300 GB of data in one single run. You have billions of reads like this in a single file. How do you put it together? Okay, and that is where the computational science has to come into picture. Different algorithms and computation, I'll tell you why it is so intense. It is like you take a book, okay, put it in a shredder. On the right hand side, you have the shreds. And now if I ask you to put the shreds back and to make the book again, how complex it will be. That is exactly the task we have, right? You have the entire genome, which is the book on the left hand side. You shred it into small sequence pieces, which is what the sequencers give you. Few hundreds or thousands of nucleotides at a time out of the 3.3 billion. So those are the shreds in front of you. And then now you stitch them back so that you can get the entire book. How do we find out what is next to what, right? It's actually computationally a very difficult task to do this. So of course, mathematicians had to come into the Bruin algorithm, if you know what that is, was used. One of the first algorithms that was able to precisely allow the mapping of 2 reads based on partial homologies, okay? Something common. Then you also bootstrap to the next one, okay? And that's how it is stitched to make larger and larger contigs, which eventually give rise to the entire genome. So it's a stitching exercise, computationally very intense. Some of the computers that we have that we use for this kind of assembly have huge amount of RAM, because the requirement is almost like for genome assembly, we use a computer assembly that cluster that has 1 terabyte of RAM, okay? So it's humongous. This is the kind of data that you have. It's really big data. And imagine this is just for one condition, for one person. If you have genomes of the entire population, okay, a country like India, how much of data, the volume of data it would be, and how do we process all of that data? Let's say you want to extract some information out of that data, that in a country like India, how many people have this genetic disorder or some epigenetic condition? Do we have even the computational infrastructure to handle this kind of data? What kind of algorithms will we use? These are the questions that people are now beginning to ask. I will not go into that. I'll just rush through the human context, because this is the last set of information that I'm going to give you. Examples that directly relate to us. So again, we all know evolution has proceeded like this, from apes to humans. But then we have not stopped here. We continue to evolve, right? And especially because of all these changes in the modern world, the rate of evolution has accelerated. So what do we have now? We actually continue to evolve into something like this. Okay. And this particular picture actually tells us that our evolution is now going to be dominated by, to a large extent, by social media. What does that mean? It actually means that you need not be confined into a small room. Even in a crowded area, you can be confined, you can be isolated. You have a device to which you are hooked onto, right? So that confinement, that isolation does something inside your body, right? Because you are affecting your mind. One of the reasons why the mental health issues have cropped up is also because of this kind of confinements that we have imposed upon ourselves. This is one aspect of our evolution. And the other aspect of our evolution is this. Our lifestyle has changed on top, if you see, more sedentary habit. And of course, the food habits have changed dramatically. Look at the bottom. Our increased dependence on fast food. So these huge changes in terms of lifestyle, the first one for in terms of our mental health, our confinements, lifestyle, our habits, less activity, and of course, dependence on fast food have now created a havoc. And I'll give you examples of that. So much so that Aldous Huxley actually said that medical science has made such a tremendous progress that there is hardly any human left. Okay. And this is the truth. We actually rarely see a perfectly healthy and fit individual these days. You know, everybody has some problem or the other. BP, diabetes. In fact, in COVID, many people discovered that they have diabetes because we normally don't even know our health status. So this is what it means, that the question is really alarming. And this is beautifully represented in this rendition. You can go to this site, www.worldmapper.org. You can put any disease that you like to see, and it will basically show you the world map in a contorted fashion, which is contorted to fit in the burden of that disease. Okay. So the first one on top is lower birth weight. So the country that has the highest lower birth weight rate is the biggest in the map here. And of course, I don't have to tell you which country that is. And look at the American continents. Okay. It has become a thin thread because they don't have this problem. Diabetes, again, look at where India is. Another problem, any other non-communicable disorder, see where India is. And of course, non-communicable disorders are also higher in the American countries. But the status of India in all of this has become really critical. And I'll give you why that has happened. Over 80 million patients with diabetes in 2020 in India. We are again very soon going to be the diabetes capital of the world. 1/4 children in affluent urban schools are obese. Okay, you go to a city like Delhi, you will see this all the time. So there are so many things associated with poverty, undernutrition, and overnutrition that come together. And the young and the poor are increasingly affected by diabetes kind of situations, and even now cardiovascular situations. So finally, it is the improper diets that have been shown to be risk factors for diseases. I'm going to show you one experiment which actually shows you how diet can directly affect your epigenetic constitution that will affect your health. So to see this entire connection between this, one very, very long-term experiment was done, and that is to see the connection between diet and the epigenome and the phenotype leading to either health or disease. So that was this experiment, okay, where we actually performed a multi-generational undernutrition experiment. This was a brainchild of Dr. Hardikar, one of my collaborators, who was at Pune and now has moved to Australia. What he actually conceived was an experiment that took 13 years, okay? This example I'm giving for students, because some of the experiments can take really long time. So he actually built a cohort of animals which have been serially undernourished for 50 generations. Okay, so that is the model. So you take one set of rats, allow them to eat only half of the diet that they are supposed to eat every day. So 50% undernourishment, 50 generations. Okay, that itself took 12 years. Okay, assuming that few months is the generation time. You do this 50 generations, it generated a undernourished model. And then followed by that, he provided regular diet, not high-fat diet. Okay, just a regular diet for two generations. So that is called recuperation. After doing this, what was found was profound. I mean, if I show you the next picture, you'll be astonished. See what happened. Panel A, okay, C is the control animal, and R2 is the animal which has eaten the regular diet after 50 generations of his or her forefathers being undernourished. 30% increase in body weight. You can see an obese rat right there, okay? And you see in the graph also how much of body weight has increased. Panel C, okay, to see how much of fat deposits are there, the rats were subjected to MRI. The white deposits are fats, okay? And you can see the subcutaneous fat from the left versus the right. You see such a huge increase in the deposition of fat. These rats, mind you, have not eaten anything high fat. They have eaten regular food. It is just that their forefathers were malnourished for multiple generations, okay? This recapitulates, actually the idea was to recapitulate what happened to the whole country of India, basically the masses. I'm talking about 80%, okay, not the elites. The 80% of the society went through malnourishment from 18th century onwards for various socio-economical political reasons until the early 1990s, okay? Huge amount of malnutrition across the country. And now in the last 30 years, what has happened is because of globalization, opening up of economy, there is increased access to a high energy diet. I would not say, or high calorie diet. I would not necessarily say increased nutrition, because nutrition is different. We just have higher access to food, high calorie food. You go to any village, you'll find chips and soft drinks and everything abundantly. Okay, you don't find the traditional snacks, but you find all of this everywhere in the world right now, especially in India. That has changed our phenotype dramatically. Okay, and that is what is causing this next wave of epidemics of non-communicable disorders in the Indian population. Alarmingly, I mean, this is something that policymakers really have to pay attention. It is all epigenetic, okay? Because we have had a history of malnutrition, now if you consume more calories, it's all going to go and increase your waist, nothing else. And of course, along with that, increase your propensity for all kinds of non-communicable diseases like cardiovascular, diabetes, and it's happening. It's out there. The data is out there for everyone to see. There's no secret about it. I'll just flash few examples. Bariatric surgery, which is done in extreme obesity, actually causes problems which are there even in the sperms of those individuals, and they pass on those, I would say, high obesity genes to the next generation. Not just obesity, even stress can be transmitted via sperms to the next generation. So this particular paper, which came out in the proceedings of US National Academy of Sciences, looked at paternal stress and in an animal model, how that gets transmitted to the next generation through another set of small microRNAs that are packaged along with the genome. Okay, so if you saw my abstract, what I've written there is that we actually think that we are only passing our genes to the next generation. That's not true anymore. We're actually passing our lifetime of experiences, bad habits, good habits, everything through our gametes, ova or the sperm, to the next generation. Okay, and that's very, very profound to understand. I mean, that's the only, I would say, most profound observation and correlation that we have now to see how the epigenetic changes that we accumulate throughout our interaction, lifetime interaction with the environment, it could be diet, it could be habits, it could be fitness levels, everything, how that affects what we pass on to the next generation. And that's why what is important is, so this is the take home, the summary of what I talked about. The environmental factors, including our diet, have profound influence on gene expression patterns, the molecular changes, which are governed by the epigenetic modifications. The highlights, the period of exposure or treatment during lifetime of an individual plays a major role in determining the outcome of the diet-induced changes. The earlier it is, the more the worse it is actually in terms of outcome. But of course, it can be good also. If you have an early life intervention, then also it can make a good change for rest of the time of your lifetime. The silver lining in this whole thing is the reversibility of such changes can be exploited as a strategy for therapeutic interventions. So it's not all dark that I'm telling you. It can be, much can be done because it's not genetic. Because if it was genetic, you cannot change it. There is no gene therapy yet. So if this was affecting our gene sequences, there is nothing we could have done with it. Like the genetic disorders. If you have sickle cell anemia, you're stuck with it for the rest of the life. Hemophilia. But epigenetic changes can be reversed easily. And that is what is happening now for disease like cancer. Epigenetic therapeutic interventions are already in the clinical trials, and some of them are coming to the market very soon. So that is the good part. So the bottom line here is the life within life. Okay, this is a cartoon that is drawn by my student Sneha. This is an epigenetic circle of life. What you see here is a pregnant woman, and there is a baby in the womb. But what is more important is the baby inside the baby, the unborn fetus, okay, which are basically the gametes, precursors of the ovary of the next third generation. People have seen effects all the way up to the third generation. Okay, so if you take care of this particular window, which is the most critical window of lifetime, you can actually affect generations coming next and the generation beyond that. So I always keep saying that every year Indian contingent comes back from Olympics, we say, oh, okay, for next Olympics, we should create new set of champions. 4 years is a very small window to do this, you know. You need to actually work on the grandparents of those champions which will be playing in the Olympics after 20 years or 30 years, which is what other countries did, like China, you know. The average height of Chinese persons were much less than Indians just 50 years ago. And now their average height, average weight has increased both in men and women. And of course, when it comes to Olympics, you know, they are competing neck to neck with the United States. So that's just because they have targeted this window through proper nutrition and many other things that we can talk about some other time. So it's very important to manage this, understand this, and epigenetics is beautiful because it is reversible. You can actually make a difference here. And I just want to stop here by thanking my group, which did all the work, the collaborators, and the funding support that I received in all these years to run the Center of Excellence program. And thank you all for your attention.
We'll open the floor for questions now. You can type in your questions in the chat box, or else you can raise your hand and we can unmute you and you can ask your questions. So there is a question on Dr. Galande on the chat box.
Yes, I'm trying to locate it.
In the meantime, Shankar, can we unmute Shankar Dhar and he can ask his question?
Anybody wants to go live? You can ask questions till I read these.
Sanjeev, this is DK here.
Yeah, hi DK.
Hey, hi. It was mind-boggling, and for me, it's a lot of learning. I mean, I had no clue about ABC of what you talked about, but now it makes a lot of sense. Where does the, in fact, if I come to your takeaway suggestions, a balanced diet and all of those things which can reverse whatever has happened, right?
Yes.
How it can be cured further. So one is the nutritional aspect you talked about. What about the so-called these days more popular is the yoga, the exercises? Does it also have any impact, or any research has been done? on breathing exercises or something?
Yes, of course. I mean, any kind of exercise is good for the body. Yoga is a mind-body exercise, and many other types of exercise which will increase your cardio as well as muscular fitness. So it is shown to add to your physiological fitness levels and therefore improving overall health. Now people have been actually able to correlate with the epigenetic changes also. So that's more recent. So research in the last 20 years have shown effects at the level of regular physiological changes that happen through various types of exercises, including breathing, yoga, etc. It's only now that people have been able to see some kind of measurable correlative and causative changes at the epigenetic level also, which is quite interesting, because you are basically, it's all about rewiring the circuit, right? You have changes in a particular way and you want to reverse some part of it so that you regain your balance of health. So that's what is happening. Yes, it is useful.
Thank you. Thank you, Sanjeev.
I can read some of these questions.
So let me read one of the questions for you.
Yeah, please.
I will read one of the questions. The first one which came in the chat box. Okay.
Sure.
So just give me a second. Yeah, so the question is from, I don't know the name. It's question says, is this change pharmacological intervention permanent, or when you withdraw it, the molecular changes are reversed?
That's a good question. Some of these changes get reversed permanently, and if the status of the individual stays the same, so in case of the animal model, for example, if they are no longer separated from the mother, then there is no need to give another pharmacological intervention. But if they continue to have that trauma over and over again, then they will require repeated treatment. And you see that in humans also. Okay. That's why we need to revisit doctors, because one-time therapy or one-time treatment is not always sufficient. So if the trauma, if the cause repeats, then the treatment also sometimes has to repeat.
All right. So there's a question from Sandeep saying, it says, has any cancer profiling done for different population groups? And has there been any significant variances?
Yes. So especially for cancer genetics, huge amount of data has actually been available now for multiple different types of cancers. Most notably breast cancer, colorectal cancer, oral cancer, some other types of cancers. So let's talk about breast cancer. So breast cancer is very, very, I would say, the topmost country is actually United States. And that is linked with the exposure to multiple different types of mutagenic substances through the lifestyle, carcinogenic substances. Also, there was a lot of data in the 80s and 90s about increased use of plastics. Okay. In fact, the plastic cans that we use, gallon jars for storing milk and fruit juices, etc., were shown to release compounds in the interior, in the milk or any other liquids that promoted, that they actually stimulated estrogen hormone. Okay. And obviously that will affect the physiology of the people who drink those. And that was linked to increase in the tendency for developing breast cancer in the Northern American population. So obviously that's why now people have moved away from plastic for storing food items, or there's a different type of plastic that is being used. Similarly, there, exposure to radiation in the 50s and 60s to all the nuclear tests and the fallout of the nuclear tests is also one of the causative reasons that people have thought about for increased in the susceptibility for cancers through the mutations that have happened. So like this, there could be geographical reasons for exposure to certain type of carcinogenic substances or mutagenic radiations or lifestyles. Okay. So people have also done studies where they have looked at cancer predisposition of people from a different country who have settled into, let's say, United States. And this actually has been done for people who have settled over generations, but gone from India to United States, let's say. In those people also, eventually they have seen that there is an increase in the tendency for different types of cancers. So it's all about your exposure to different types of cancer causing substances.
Right. Thank you. Shankar, you can unmute yourself and ask the question. Okay, Shubhra, Shubhra Sen Gupta. Let me check.
Yeah, very interesting talk. So I just had a question. In the US, for example, there's a very high proportion of obese people also. From the point of view of being malnourished and then being exposed to high calorie food, I would understand that for the African American population. But then how does it translate for the Caucasian population in America? Is it just because of fatty food or?
Yeah, I mean, that's a very interesting question. I'm glad you asked this because it's again something to do with the gene environment interaction. Okay, so if you actually looked at the world mapper maps that I showed you, where size of the country is proportional to the disease burden, you will see that African continent, Asia and the American continents showed completely different changes. Okay, so for example, African continent is very different when it comes to the change to the susceptibility for diabetes with respect to Asian continents and American continents. So when the same people, if you look at now those who have been in US, so the slaves from African continent migrated and settled in the US, and now that's a large population we talk about compared to the Caucasians. If you look at their differences, it's something to do with multi-generational malnutrition followed by access to high calorie diets in the African population, whereas the Western population has had increased access over the years to high calorie diets. Okay, so that way their changes are not as dramatic as the African population. So the problems that we see in the Caucasian population are because of continuous overnutrition. The problems in the other populations is because of history of malnutrition followed by a rapid increase in the accessibility to high calorie diets.
Okay, let me read one question
from the chat. Can I ask now?
Shankar, please go ahead.
Because my mic was a little problem. Okay, I thank you for this nice presentation. I have a couple of two, three small questions about what I learned. One, you mentioned that there is an up sensory, up direction, down direction, one of the
the genes. Yes.
So I was wondering what do you mean by up can be down or down can be up? I mean, this one thing. Second question would be related to when you say, I read it many places, that okay, so now we can make a custom made or individual medication by sequencing genes. So question is that whether that take care of the, or have we learned that low dose, see the law of minimum dose, that also customized individually or still it goes an average in terms of the medication dose? And third, related to that any medicine which we take in our lifetime, especially related to painkiller, antibiotics, and all those molecules, that also transfers through gene to my next generation? I mean, all these molecules together with the gene, it passes through or not? So these are the three small questions.
Okay, so I'll start with the last one first. So regarding the small molecules, obviously the small molecules will not pass to the next generation. Okay, there is a way of filtering those molecules in our body. What will get passed on to the next generation is the effect of it. Okay. So for example, you took example of antibiotics. Antibiotics will change your microbiome. Okay. And change of microbiome will change genes and their epigenetic modification in your body. That can be passed to the next generation. Okay. So the antibiotic will not go. It is its effect, its after effects will go to the next generation. So if you have a prolonged use of antibiotics or any other drug, it will affect your genes and those effects will be passed on to the next generation. Okay, so it has been seen.
It can be good or bad, both ways. It is always bad.
People have seen actually people who have long history of drug abuse, drug substances, their children also have effects in terms of increased anxiety, stress, aggression, etc., just because of this drug abuse in the parents. So they may not necessarily take the drugs, but they will actually have effects based on what the parents have had. So this is the bad effect. But if parents have had, let's say, fantastic, I would say the best healthy diet that one can have, one can ever have in that particular setting, those effects will also be passed to the next generation. So that is the good part of it, you know, it works both ways. And then coming back to your first question, you talked about the genes up and down. So those are actually just like switches on and off. As I said, 20,000 genes, let's say you have every cell, every gene rather in our cell has this switch on or off. In your brain cells at a time, maybe 9,000 switches will be on, whereas cell in a liver will have about 8,000 switches to be on out of the 20,000. But the 9,000 in the brain and 8,000 in liver cell will be different. They will not be the same. So it's a subset of these genes that are active in different cell types. In fact, that's what makes them different. Okay.
Right. But each combination of each disease, you gave an example of that tumor, but say there are many diseases. So these sensory things, it makes a combination of, or it is stored for particular disease or something we have learned about that, or it becomes a combination of that.
Yeah, so it is combination always. What we study is for a particular disease, but our body doesn't look at only one thing at a time, right? We are exposed to so many different things. It's a combination of all of those factors. The problem is, so far it has been for scientists, it's a story of an elephant and six blind men. We only study what we see is within our vicinity, right? Or within our capability. But that's only a tip of the iceberg. You need to see in totality. So because of this various technological breakthroughs, what I wanted to impress upon you all is that now we are going towards that kind of a totalitarian picture. Otherwise, earlier we were only seeing only small parts, you know. So that's why modern medicine was not in the best possible shape until now, because we never understood the total situation, the entire, I would say, genomic and epigenomic changes. We only looked at one particular symptom and treated that only, but we don't look at the entire body. And that is what exactly need to be done. We need to look at it holistically.
No, I know that the new science coming, that is system as a whole, but yes, that concept coming in medical science. But I was just wondering, I mean, it's corollary. Sorry, I'm taking little time for my, I study little on this. I'm saying that then how it is different, say, from homeopathic, because see, that concept was a body as a whole, okay? And yeah, individualistic, and from this conventional medicine we are going towards that concept of individualistic in a scientific way. So that is maybe non-scientific way, but that is also holistic and individualistic. So are we going to that direction, or acknowledging that maybe best approach rather than isolation, like heart doctor and, you know, I'll separate, you know.
So this question actually requires a separate discussion, very long discussion, because you have opened up a completely different Pandora's box by talking about homeopathy, which according to me may not necessarily be in a scientific framework. So obviously one has to look at holistic way of approaching various medical problems. That need not necessarily mean holistic medicine. Okay, medicine can still be extremely modern type of medicine, but you have to have an understanding at a holistic level. You understand the difference? So for I'll give you a slightly more clear example of that. So people are giving drugs for some kind of cancer, let's say, to all patients. out of which only for 20% of the people it was working. Okay, so all other 80%, they are actually going through huge amount of side effects without any benefit of that medicine, which means that you have not understood what that medicine is doing to the body, and you have not understood bodies of all these people, their physiology. So one way of doing that is to first understand the physiology of everyone, their genetic makeup, their epigenetic makeup, and then you precisely pinpoint various attributes in these populations and classify them, okay, in different types of people, group A, group B, group C, etc. And then you say that medicine N works for group A but not for group B, and prescribe that. So in now in cancers, this is something that we have achieved very, very nicely. These days, if you go to oncologists, they will prescribe a test, which if it is done, they will tell you that these are the medicines that are applicable to you. So like this, if we keep on doing for multiple different diseases, same is true for diabetes. Okay, there are multiple genetic and epigenetic factors that need to be considered. You can't have the same medicine for all patients.
Let me take one question from Ashish Tripathi from the chat box. You know, it says, what are the few differentiating traits which we can expect in future offspring of people staying in highly polluted locations like Delhi NCR and people staying in locations like, let's say, Uttarakhand or Himachal? And I would also add probably SNU.
Yeah. How many people are here from Delhi NCR?
A large number.
Yeah. So, I mean, obviously there will be effects, but you know, pollution is of so many different types, from sound to chemicals to food. The pollution that we are talking about is mostly particulate pollution in air in the area of Delhi that will affect respiratory system to the large extent, okay, which is only one system in your body. But the other kinds of pollution that is happening through food adulteration, through eating various packaged foods, for example, which have multiple different additives, which are not considered problematic at all. One example I'll give you is the so-called sugar-free that we add, okay? People think that they will add sugar free and they can be free about it, but not worry about eating too much of sugary substances. But the so-called sugar free that we add is actually now shown to be also causing a condition that is precursor of diabetes. So it is not the amount of glucose in your blood, it is the synthetic addition that we do. If you go to a supermarket and read what is contents for any packaged food, it will have multiple edulcorants, okay, which are stabilizing agents. The number starts with E, okay, E122 or E124, whatever it is. The moment you see E in a food substance, you should be very careful, because these edulcorants are actually the ones that are causing multiple problems. So to me, that pollution that affects your food is much more damaging to your body than anything else, because other things you can wash off. Your respiratory tract, you can wash off. You go from dirty air to clean air, you're fine. But the food things is like you eat it once and it somewhere gets stored in your body, okay? And it's very difficult to wash off. So about food, one has to be very, very careful. That is one level of pollution that I am putting at the topmost. Everything else you can negate more easily. Of course, it will have bad effects, like particles in your air will have damaging consequences on your respiratory tract. But any pollution, anything that affects your food, is actually going to damage your life for a very long period of time. That's why you should be very careful about what goes in your mouth. And typically what is very tasty is not necessarily the best thing for your body.
Absolutely. So I think we're done with most of the questions, and I would like to, thank you, Dr. Galande, for this enlightening talk, you know, making all of us aware about some of the most complex topics of epigenetics using a tremendous energy. You know, it was also visible in the online mode, right? In the most simplified language. I think not only us, but our next three generations have also learned some stories about epigenetics, right? So many thanks for this wonderful and exciting and enlightening session. And I must thank all the faculty members, all the staff members, and all the students for joining today's session. And I think you've already set the context for rest of the talks in this series. You've already scored a century. I think we'll have many more wonderful talks coming up our way. Thank you so much. Thank you.